Good morning. First, to breaking news out of Sydney. There's been a fall in COVID-19 cases. 18 new infections in the past 24 hours in Sydney, some of which were moving around the community while infectious. Chris O'Keefe joins me in the studio now. Chris, the numbers are down on yesterday. I guess, though, we shouldn't read too much into this.
Not yet, because obviously the effects of the Sydney-wide lockdown will not be felt for many, many days. And Dr. Kerry Chan today said that we won't know exactly where we're at in terms of this outbreak for another probably 5 days. But nonetheless, you'd rather have 18 than 88, and that's where we're at the moment. So 18 new cases. But instead of the raw numbers, there's two key points to take out of this. 59,000 tests in 24 hours is an amazing result. But of the 18 that have been picked up, six of them were already in the community. So moving around the community while infectious, not in isolation. And there is a serious concern there, because that means there is a good chance that they've infected more people. Now, there's been a couple of issues in terms of where people have picked this up. There's now four children at South Coogee Public School who have tested positive. So all 500 kids that go to that school are now deemed close contacts, and all of them and their parents are being told to quarantine for 14 days and get a test. There is also a student around the corner at Emmanuel Public School, at primary school at Ranwick, and so the parents and students are being asked to go and get tested there too. But there's a really interesting one. The West Hoxton party. This is this party that was about 30 people were at. 24 people now from that party have tested positive of the 30 that were there. The six who didn't were vaccinated because they were healthcare workers, and one was an aged care worker. So it just goes to show how these vaccines are effective. But, you know, in terms of where we're at right now in with the Sydney lockdown, I think Kerry Chan and Gladys Berejiklian will be happy with the number 18, but they're certainly not counting their chickens.
We will need at least another 5 days to see this picture turn around. The restrictions came in towards the end of last week. There were other mitigations earlier on. But the cases we have now reflect exposures that occurred 5 days ago.
Chris, interestingly, the police did speak today as well, and they've been out and about issuing these infringement notices for people not staying in locations.
Yeah, so 44 fines have been issued by the police, and are about $1,000 each, so it's a pretty significant fine. But there's been ones from not wearing face masks to, you know, being found halfway down the south coast when you've lived in Sydney. But the most interesting one, and a bit bizarre really, is two men that were found at the Royal National Park. They were on a secluded beach and they were nude sunbaking. A deer's popped out of the Royal National Park. It startled them. They've run into the bushes. They've had to call for help because they got lost. So the SES have come, the police have come. They said, hang on a second, you're from Sydney, what are you doing on the beach? So, you know, that was a nude sunbaking trip gone wrong for them. But just goes to show the stay-at-home orders, they are being enforced, because without enforcement, none of it works.
OK, Chris, thank you. Well, Sydney's eastern suburbs remain the epicentre of the latest outbreak. Ruth Wynne-Williams is in Vaucluse for us. Ruth, more venues there undergoing deep cleaning this morning.
Yeah, Mark, and we are seeing some progress here at Bell Cafe. This was one of the affected sites we were notified of very early in this latest outbreak. A positive case visited here several times between June 10th and June 15th, but we've just seen them lose their protective gear here this morning. So they've spent quite a bit of time making this space safe again. It is one of a number of sites right throughout our city that will be getting very similar treatment over coming days. In the east, though, you've just heard from Chris, they are focusing on a number of schools, in particular that Emmanuel school that we heard of overnight, another case there. There will be a clean taking place there over coming days. And now the South Coogee Public School, the number of cases rising there this morning. We are on school holidays, but the Premier has just issued some advice for students and for parents of the people who attend that school. Here is what she had to say.
Because of those additional cases, and because there's also a number of interactions between the school groups in the different year groups, all students are now close contacts and must get tested and self-isolate for 14 days regardless of a negative test. There was also a child at the Emmanuel School that was present whilst infectious, and information is going out to that school community defining who is a close and casual contact.
Mark, you can understand why there is so much concern over these schools being named as contact sites. There are hundreds of people that attend those schools, and it stretches right throughout the east, the number of people who go to those schools. This morning at the beaches, we saw a large number of people out and about. They were all taking advantage of that rule that allows them to get out and exercise. But Bondi was very busy this morning. Our CBD, though, was fairly quiet. Roads were empty. The footpaths were pretty devoid of pedestrians in the CBD. We do know compliance officers will be hitting the streets today. They will be out and about, Mark, and you can bet they will be paying particular attention to the people exercising, especially those around the beaches and here in the east. Mark?
OK, Ruth, thank you. Well, to Queensland now, where millions of people are on the verge of lockdown, with new restrictions just announced for the state's southeast. Lane Cowcutt has the latest.
There's real fear in Queensland about the rapid spread of the very contagious Delta variant, with the Premier warning she won't hesitate to take strong action. There were two new cases of community transmission, a female mine worker with the variant who flew into Brisbane and travelled home to the Sunshine Coast and began a road trip with her family, and another linked to a separate cluster. To try to get on top of any widespread, masks will be mandatory from 1 a.m. tomorrow throughout 11 local government areas in the southeast. They must be worn at all times, in public, at work and on public transport, with restrictions back in force, limiting the numbers at weddings and funerals, in cafes, restaurants, pubs and clubs, and the number of visitors to homes, with the southeast effectively one step away from another lockdown.
We've got to act very quickly. The next 24 to 48 hours are going to be very crucial in Queensland.
Fears are held also for another 169 miners from the Northern Territory site who have flown back into Queensland, with authorities racing to locate and contact them to be tested and to quarantine.
We are rapidly testing all 170.
The Premier also warned about another hard border lockdown with New South Wales if things continue to worsen there.
Well, the worsening COVID crisis has sent the AFL schedule into chaos, forcing the league to consider a Melbourne hub to keep the season alive. Christina Hearn reports.
Well, who would have thought that Melbourne is shaping up as the place to be? It was only this time last year that the 10 Victorian clubs fled the state for Queensland. But as the AFL is considering a return to hub mode, we could be set for matches played almost every day of the week. Already it looks like more matches this weekend will have to be relocated to Melbourne. The Western Bulldogs touched down in Melbourne overnight without any drama after playing their match in Perth behind closed doors, a decision that was made at the last minute. Meanwhile, our borders tightened even further overnight. Greater Darwin is now locked out. Greater Brisbane and Perth have been declared orange zones, and authorities not ruling out locking out all of New South Wales altogether.
As the nation faces one of the most serious COVID scares since the pandemic began, the Prime Minister has called an urgent meeting of National Cabinet. Let's get the latest from political reporter Eliza Edwards. Eliza, what's on the agenda?
Yeah, Mark, there's plenty for leaders to work through in this virtual meeting to be held late this afternoon, but it all revolves around the current outbreaks. Premiers will get a briefing about vaccine supplies. There'll also be a discussion about banning high-risk overseas arrivals from quarantining next door to low-risk domestic travellers. That's how a Northern Territory mine worker caught the virus in Queensland. And importantly, leaders will talk about testing and vaccinating those who work in our quarantine system. We know it was an unvaccinated limo driver who sparked the Bondi cluster. So we could see out of this more unified guidelines on vaccinations for frontline workers. And the federal government's also facing calls to open up vaccinations to younger age groups who are also vulnerable to the highly infectious Delta strain of the virus.
Not yet in a position where we can just let this virus out, because as you say, young people are vulnerable. We've certainly seen people in their 20s and 30s getting extremely sick, ending up in ICU and dying, not commonly, but enough that it would be a national tragedy if it happened. And hence we do have to, we've got to bring in these restrictions. And of course, we're going to need to keep doing it until we have been able to offer the vaccine to young people.
While the focus is firmly on current case numbers, the Treasurer has released a snapshot of how COVID-19 will impact our future. The intergenerational report, released every 5 years, acts as a bit of a crystal ball forecast for what the nation could look like in 40 years' time. It shows the pandemic will leave its mark on Australia.
The economic impact of COVID-19 is not short-lived. COVID-19 will see our population smaller and older and our debt levels higher.
Mark, the lasting impacts are concerning, but the more immediate risk of the virus spreading has left much of the country on edge.
Eliza, thank you.